Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews.
Why, look, it's Bob Simpson in his short pants on the Davenport.
Are you nuts?
Homer is my hero.
Say it in American.
Our guest tonight, the woman behind the voice of Lisa Simpson. It's actress and voiceover artist Yeardley Smith.
I was teased mercilessly for my voice as a kid. And so when people ask me, did you ever, when you got The Simpsons, was this, you know, hooray, huzzah? You know, voiceover was never part of my plan for world domination. Never, not ever.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Yeardley, it's great to have you on Frank Buckley Interviews.
Thanks, Frank.
I'm so looking forward to talking to you about Small Town Dicks, the podcast, about Paperclip Limited, your production company, and the special approach that you take with your production company, and, of course, Lisa Simpson. Do you get tired of talking about Lisa Simpson?
Never, not ever.
No?
I really, really love her.
Yeah?
Yeah. And I do feel as though she's so fully formed that she exists quite rightly separate from me. You know, people are, they're attached to an animated character. She lives in 2D, and yet people feel like she's more real than a lot of the real characters on television, than, you know, flesh and blood characters on television.
Dad, I'm seeing you through new eyes. You've become the hero of my book.
The guy who kills the mockingbird?
No one kills a mockingbird.
Whoa, spoiler alert.
Writers talk about the fact that as they're writing, their characters begin to speak to them and their characters lead the way in the storytelling. I know that The Simpsons is scripted and you have terrific writers, but does that ever happen to you as a character?
It's not a collaboration in that way. You know, they don't invite me into the writer's room and go, hey, but... two things. One, Lisa Simpson is all of our writers, most of whom are men, and she really is the embodiment of their childhood angst, where they were misfits, they were the smartest people in the room,
right.
You know, they didn't have any friends, and so they work out all of that through Lisa Simpson.
You're the voice of the writers.
I am. I really am.
And I love the way you just made me feel safer.
She respects me. This is even better than the time the milk duds in the vending machine knocked down a Three Musketeers bar, too. Woohoo! Man beats machine! Oh!
But my contribution to Lisa Simpson in terms of sort of looking out for her, for instance, if the writers write something for her that I feel like she wouldn't say, I will always fight that fight. I might not win it, but at a certain point, and I'm very, very careful about walking this line, but in some ways I feel like I know Lisa Simpson better than anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And so if somebody is really mean to her and she doesn't have a response to that, or if she just does something so wildly out of character that I'm like, dude, it's just not her, then I will always speak up.
And how far into the process did you have the confidence to say, I know Lisa Simpson better than you know Lisa Simpson?
That's a good question. It had to have been a solid decade.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I still feel as though I'm really only 33 1/3% of the success of that character. It starts with the writers. Then we get it. And as actors, we, of course, do those lines. And then they cut together the best of those four takes. We do each scene four times. And then that goes to the animators. And the animators draw to the audio that they get.
Mm-hmm.
You could not have... The Simpsons would not be a success without each of those three incredibly important pieces.
Mm.
It's unique in that way.
How long did it take you to find her voice, both the physical voice and also her voice as a character?
Potatoes! So many eyes, and yet it cannot see. Potatoes! So many eyes, and yet it cannot see. Potatoes! So many eyes, and yet it cannot see.
Her voice, her emotional intelligence, who she is as a being, really got fleshed out in the half hour when we went from the little bumpers we used to do on Tracy Ullman, where we told a whole story in a minute, mm-hmm. split up in 20-second segments.
87 to 89.
Yes. And then we spun off into a half hour show. And that's when Lisa Simpson really got a personality. Before that, she was just kind of a girl version of Bart. She was just kind of a brat.
Right.
But James L. Brooks, our executive producer, said she should be a prodigy, she should be a genius, and I want her to play the saxophone. Now, I'm none of those things, but I
do... Some people say you're a genius, but okay.
It's much too gracious. I do remember as a kid, I didn't quite know where I fit in either. I was a theater geek, and I didn't really do anything else, but I was quite good at it. Mm. So my feeling in retrospect is, if you're good at anything as a young person, whether it's sports or math or theater or singing, whatever it is, it sets you apart from your peer group. Now you're automatically an outsider. Even if you have friends who are happy for you, Right. There's probably also a group of friends who are not happy for you. So that creates, it can create a real struggle when you're a young person. And so I definitely experienced some of that. And Lisa Simpson, you know, every time the writers give her something, they take it away. Right. Whether it's a pony or a friend or a win, Right. That kid has more resilience than I'll ever have in my entire life.
I want to get back to James L. Brooks in a second, how you developed the character, but I want to pursue this for a second. You talked about being a theater geek as a kid. At what age?
I did my first play in the sixth grade. We did I Remember Mama, which is a very old play. Uh-huh. And I played the youngest daughter. It wasn't a very big part, but I got huge laughs. And I remember that feeling of, oh. But even before that, there was a woman in my neighborhood when I was growing up in Washington, D.C., who used to get all the neighborhood kids together in the summer. She turned her tiny one-car garage into a theater. She would round us all up, dress us all up, and then we would lip-sync to musicals like The Sound of Music and Fiddler on the Roof. And I thought, oh, yes, this is for me.
Really?
Sign me up. Yeah.
That's fantastic. But then in sixth grade, you get this part, and you walk out onto the stage for the first time. You remember seeing the audience? Do you remember that feeling, before the first laughs? Were you nervous?
Oh, my
were
God,
you
so nervous.
At home?
Terrified. And I think I literally cried for 2 weeks before the first performance because I was terrible. I was terrified that I was going to screw it up, that I was going to fail miserably. And then, but I had, you know, despite not, I wasn't very sporty growing up, although it turns out I'm pretty coordinated and quite athletic, which I found out in my 20s when I started taking aerobics classes, if anybody remembers those.
Sure. And then step classes after that,
yes,
I'm sure.
Yes, did all that. And so I didn't have a lot of experience being face-to-face with my own sense of competition and ambition. But clearly it lived in me because I just thought, I will conquer this fear and I will do it well. And so I remember stepping out on stage, saying my first line, getting a huge laugh and thinking, okay, I feel like, for once, I feel like I belong.
I want you to do something with Lisa.
I am. Isn't that right, honey? Oops.
Lisa is the world's favorite middle child. Where are you in the birth order? And
I'm the youngest of two.
You're the youngest.
Yeah. I have a brother who's a year older than me.
Okay.
Yeah. So I had that on lockdown because Lisa's older brother is Bart, obviously. And I was a brat to my brother who was not nice to me. So.
Well, now everyone knows.
Now they all know. He's a lovely guy now, of course.
I want to go back to Lisa Simpson, and you were talking about James L. Brooks and how you were trying to figure out Lisa Simpson. Mm. What did he say to you? How did you come back to it? How do you create the character?
It was a pretty interestingly symbiotic relationship. Again, you know, my point of difference growing up was that I was in theater and I was good at it, and I got a lot of attention for it. And the writer's point of difference was that for most of them, they were the smartest kid in the room. They were skipping two grades at a time. And so when they wrote Lisa Simpson, although our circumstances were different, our experience was so similar. Hmm. And so I was able to read those words on that page and go, oh, I get this. I totally get that.
No one likes feeling out of place. That's how I felt in Springfield. But I sucked it up for 8 years.
Right from the get-go, or at least once we transitioned to half-hour episodes, they imbued her with so much humanity and compassion. And she was not afraid to express her anxiety and her vulnerability and her utter joy, that it was all of the things. It was like, all I have to do is follow this roadmap and it will actually heal my own heart.
Wow, that's profound.
Yeah, it is profound. I feel such a connection to that little character. And I feel like when the show is over, you know, we're about halfway through, but when it's over, that it will be as though one of my very best friends has moved away and is never coming back, and that will be incredibly sad.
I hate to see a poor chump cry.
More of my conversation with Yeardley Smith when we come back.
The second grade was grim, but Jem assured me that the older I get, the better school would be.
Who says my class is grim? Who's Jem? What are you talking about?
That's from To Kill a Mockingbird, page 67, the book you assigned us to read.
I assigned you to read the Wikipedia article.
I was teased mercilessly for my voice as a kid. And so when people ask me, did you ever, when you got The Simpsons, was this, you know, hooray, huzzah, know, voiceover was never part of my plan for world domination, never, not ever, because I think I was teased for it, and I thought, I can't imagine how you would willfully and specifically turn that thing that had been framed as a deficit into some sort of asset. In terms of my on-camera career, which was really quite robust for many years, I never noticed it, that my voice was so funny, and I was aware also that it made me incredibly memorable. So if you didn't mind the role, however small, having that really specific imprint, then it was going to be a good partnership.
Yeah. And does it feel wonderful to think that you are celebrated for that very voice that some people said was quirky or weird or whatever they said?
What happened?
Got in a fight.
Why? What did the other kid do?
Said Dad was lazy and incompetent.
And where is this other kid?
Yo.
You got in a fight with your brother?
I want to fight with my brother.
Liar.
Let's go again.
It is, it goes right into that silo of be who you are and celebrate that.
To that end, and we'll circle back to some of the Simpsons stuff in a second, you are being honored this month with an amazing award from the Human Rights Campaign.
Yes.
And it speaks to this idea of being who you are. And I just want to read from their press release. You're receiving the National Leadership Award. Yeardley Smith is a true change maker, an extraordinary ally and partner in our fight to advance fairness and equality for LGBTQ people. Why? Why is it so important to you?
Oh, well, it's just a no-brainer. I don't think you get to cherry-pick people's human rights. And certainly, personally, I mean, as a straight ally, but as one who was bullied, who, you know, my life is extraordinary, but it certainly wasn't without its lumps and bumps. And really, in the grand scheme of things, my safety was never threatened. I was never, that I know of, discriminated against because of my sexual orientation. And again, it just, for me, it's so basic.
Yeah.
You don't get to say, just because you're not like me, you don't get to have the same privileges and human rights that I do. Don't even.
On the list of things that you've accomplished, where does this stand? Not the award, but what you have done in this movement, in awareness? How important is it to you?
It's so important, but at the same time, I always feel like, look, I'm a conduit. I've given a lot of money. I do whatever they ask me to do, but really, bottom line is that community and those people who run HRC do all the heavy lifting. Mm. If I can facilitate that, you're gonna make me cry, Frank. I'm so grateful.
Yeah.
And I consider it such a privilege to be in a position to have the time and the resources to help make the world a better place. And I have been blessed with some solid material wealth. But honestly, the best part about having so much is being able to share it with the people and the causes that mean everything to you.
Mm.
I've been, you know, between marriages and when I was alone, and I still had so much, and it's just not as good.
Yeah.
It's not as good.
What is not as good?
It's not as much fun. It's not as joyful.
If you're
to
alone.
To have nobody to go on vacation with, to not have something meaningful to help further that message, carry that ball across the goal line. If you don't have those things in your life, and you still have all these resources, it's just not as meaningful to me.
Yeah. I want to get to Small Town Dicks, this podcast.
Yes.
Fantastic. And we were talking about this before we started rolling. this fascination that we all have with real crime. And we were talking about the fact that it is on Dateline, you know, people watch it, your podcast, and it's not entertainment, it's storytelling. But these are real people who've experienced horrific things.
I think the burning food was the overwhelming smell, but once you got into her bedroom, you could tell there's some decomp going on. She'd been there a couple days. It was pretty obvious, just initially looking at her, that she had suffered stab wounds and slicing wounds to various parts of her body, her head, her face, her neck.
And I wonder what attracted you to this material.
I'm endlessly fascinated by people's stories. And so on our podcast, all of our cases are told by the detective who investigated the case. And apart from the actual events of what happened, which are, you always think, oh, there but for the grace of God go I. I could have been, and it's usually women, right? I could have been that victim in the parking lot. Somebody could have broken into my house and tried to sexually assault me, whatever the crime is. Apart from that sort of gut check, I'm so fascinated by these. Who are these people who go toward the thing that the rest of us all run from? Hmm. Who are you? And they all say it's a calling, all these detectives, that it's not a job. How and where does it go? If that's your day-to-day, seeing the worst of humanity, and in small towns, we always say big-time crime is happening in small-town USA everywhere, just with the same level of depravity and reckless disregard for human lives, just with less frequency. Mm. But the amount of work and the work product they have to produce is on the same level as you have in a big city, and yet they're dealing with many fewer resources.
This guy's good. He likely cases every place that he's going to. He's probably been in the business during daylight hours, and he's probably taking note of where cameras are, where they're not, where the blind spots are. The guy's just working through his city, going from business to business, where he goes, oh, that lock I recognize, I could take that one.
So if you're a cop in a small town agency, guaranteed you're wearing multiple hats.
Right.
You know, you're not just investigating major crimes, you're probably also assisting your colleague in a drug buy, you are part of the SWAT team, you just do it all because it's all hands on deck. And so I also really like the good guys to win. So I want to know that if there are people out there who do not value the same rules and codes of conduct that the rest of us value in order for society to function well, I want to know that there's a force bigger than me that can put that train back on the tracks. Mm.
Stay tuned for more with Yeardley Smith when we come back.
What's wrong, sweetie?
I've got that terrible feeling where I'm almost at the end of a great book, and once I finish, it's over forever.
Final thing I want to talk to you about is your production company, Paper Clip Limited.
Yes.
With Ben Cornwell.
Yes.
Why did you call it Paperclip Limited?
Two things. One, I always wish I'd invented something that everybody needs that never goes out of style, that costs mere, like, micro cents to make and could make a gazillion dollars. The paperclip, right? And two, paperclips hold things together, but not so tightly that they can't ultimately end up being pulled apart and having a life of their own. Mm. And we've started the production company. Ben and I actually have been in business together for about 9 years. Paperclip is only about 4 years old, almost 4 years old. And we started it because it's so hard to get a yes in show business. We wanted to be the people who say yes first. Mm. And we also didn't want to have a particular focus like, oh, we just do television shows, we just do films. We wanted to do things that spoke to our heart. So we develop projects across all mediums at their earliest stages. But that also actually quickly morphed into some co-financing and financing of films. We just wrapped a film in Louisiana, actually, back to the HRC event. Although they weren't a part of it, but it's a film called Gossamer Folds, and it's about a transgender woman of color who ends up befriending this little boy who moves in next door to her and her dad. Tate, the little boy, Gossamer, the woman, are both misfits, and it takes place in 1986 in small town USA, and they're just trying to figure out where they fit in. And they form this really fantastic, you're a weirdo kind of friendship. Mm-hmm. This platonic, great meeting of minds where they end up figuring out that you can have connection in the most unexpected places. Hmm. And we actually consulted with GLAAD and their and Nick Adams, head of their transgender media department, because, look, I'm 54, a white straight woman. My other producers are middle-aged straight white men. Who the hell are you to produce a film about a transgender woman? So we really wanted to get it right. Mm-hmm. And they were key in helping us avoid some of the obvious pitfalls. So, you know, people, there was a little eyebrow raising of who the hell are you?
Yeah.
But we take it very seriously, and we don't know what we don't know. So we went to the source to say, help us out here.
Fantastic. Yeardley, this is great.
Frank,
I really
you are
enjoyed this
a
conversation.
Delight.
Say it again.
You are a joy.
Now say it as Lisa Simpson.
You're a joy, Frank.
Thank you. This was a lot of fun.
Thanks for joining us. If you'd like to hear the entire uncut conversation with Yeardley Smith, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. If you'd like to share a comment about today's program, tag me on social media. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. If you'd like to share today's program with friends and family around the world, you can find it on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews. We'll see you next time.